I want you to stand with me. And as we stand together, I know it's quieter. That's all right. The message probably genders this kind of a spirit. But I want you to take your neighbor by the hand, step a little ways if you have to. And I want you to first of all pray for one thing. I want you to pray for me. I want you to pray for me. I need your prayer. I need your prayer. I need God to hear you praying for me. And I need him to hear your prayer for me and help me. Would you pray for me? Would you lift your hands, lift your heart, and say, God, help the pastor. Please pray for me. Thank you to please pray for me. Thank you for praying for me. Pray now that God would help you to hear this important message. Open our ears to hear. Open our ears to hear. These frightening scriptures are found in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 12. Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men. And whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come. Father, I approach this asking you to make me a clean and a pure vessel to deliver this message. Help every one of us to hear. Don't let the minds of young people or adults drift or be attacked of the enemy. But let us, for this time, set our mind on every word, every presence of God that is with us. In Jesus' name, everyone say amen, and you may be seated. For a great number of weeks, Sunday mornings and Sunday nights, I've been preaching on the Holy Spirit. I have endeavored to start at the simplest and to take us through a study of this most important theme of the Bible. I feel that I will yet preach on it more. But I come to this, to where I knew that I must include this, so I preach the sin against the Holy Spirit is unpardonable. I've heard preachers make and teachers make boasts. And part of their boast is there are certain things in the Bible that I've never preached, I've never taught. May God never let that be true of this preacher. I pray that God will make me an able minister according to his word of the New Testament. Cry aloud, spare not. What in the world could ever be the thinking of a teacher or a preacher that they would feel so bold as to declare that there are certain truths of the Word of God that they will not teach or preach? I never want that true of me. But I do want to preach the truth in love. I do want to preach it in the right spirit. I do want people to hear. And I do not want that to be clouded in any way by a prejudice on my part. I pray to God that I've, in these 25 years, preached to you the whole counsel of God. I've endeavored. Sometimes that includes the Word of God that says, harden not your heart. How in the world are we going to know unless we hear? Harden not your heart, as it did in the days of provocation. God said there will come a time when I will cut you off. That's difficult to preach. And one thing that makes that difficult to preach is you know it's the true word of God. He said, suddenly be cut off without remedy. The warnings of the word of God are, God's spirit will not always strive with man. People do not realize until they hear it. You can miss the day of your visitation. I believe that God wants all of these things. I read in the Word of God where people that have gone to hell, they pray that God would send someone to their family to warn them. Warn them that they not come to this horrible place. Do you remember when Brother Clendenin was preaching? He told of a sermon that he'd heard. I received that sermon. I've heard it several times. A man preached. The title of his message was, "There's No Place Like Hell." He told a story how he sat down with his children and his family. And he told them of a story of having gone to a hospital where there was a man that had cancer of the mouth. He told of the horrible stench. He told of the agony and the torture and the torment. The man talking to his family, he had seen it. He had experienced it. You couldn't stand the smell. The cries of the man in horror because they couldn't relieve the pain. But he told his children, there's no place like hell. For all that man is suffering and all that he's experiencing, there is not a man in hell that wouldn't change places with him. There's not a man in hell that wouldn't change places with the suffering man. There's no place like hell. So yes, I'm going to preach what some preachers and teachers tell you you'll never have to hear out of them. If it's in this book. If it's in this book and you're called a preacher, if you don't preach it, somehow, you've let God's people down. This is not popular. There are many scriptures regarding the Holy Spirit. A lot of things that remove people from God and God from them. I could give you a lot of scripture, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to tell you. I believe, and we're so near the end of time. We are so near the time of the coming of the Son of Man. Politically, religiously, spiritually, domestically, everywhere. Every place that you look, the Bible said it would be days of perplexity. That means there is no way out. The conditions of this world, there is no way out. I preached Wednesday night on revival. I believe in revival. Yes, I said revival is a thing of the heart. Yes. If that heart is right and you're full of God, Christ and God, you have revival. But in the Word of God, we find that He said that there would come a time when men would not heed sound doctrine. That's right. They would have itching ears. And the only thing they want to hear is smooth things. They've hardened their hearts. I'm going to say something I hope you understand. There's a lot of things. Grieve not the Spirit. We're told these things concerning the personality of the Holy Ghost. As to how that we are to live before Him. I can tell you adultery is not an unpardonable sin. I can tell you that drunkenness is not an unpardonable sin. I can sit here and name a lot of things that are not unpardonable in that sense. But there is a sense in which the unpardonable sin is to continue to harden your heart. Therefore, any sin can become unpardonable. Think about it. In this, from the scripture that we've read, this is dealing mainly, and let me deal with this part first. This is dealing mainly with the Pharisees. The Pharisees were religious. Right? The Pharisees knew Jesus Christ. They knew Him in His person. They did not know Him as of the Father. You can know all that you want to know about religion, but if you do not know this Jesus Christ, you are lost. Jesus is dealing with these Pharisees in this reading. Let's take it kind of how it goes. Did they ever see Jesus sin? No. He was sin, tempted in all points like as we are, yet without sin. Not one Pharisee. They didn't like what He said. They said, say that's what He says of Himself. They couldn't prove Him wrong. But among all that they had seen and all that they knew, they had also seen the miracles of God. They could not deny the power of God. They could not deny the miracle of God. It was irrefutable. They had clear evidence of the power of God. But yet these impressive miracles, They turned their heart against it. You've heard all your life. I'm just putting it in another way. That will leading to the unpardonable sin is to attribute the works of God to the devil. I'm going to get down to it in a minute. I hope to show you beyond any shadow of a doubt that the unpardonable sin is in word or in writing. In your heart, you cannot deny the power of God. Every one of us, sinners, hardened, adulterers, other men's wives, other women's husbands. We were corrupt, wicked, ruined. If you are born again, you cannot deny that there's only one thing that saved, and that was the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. If he saved you, you are a miracle. Don't ever, he said, if you speak a word against the Father, the Son, to be forgiven. If you speak against that Holy Ghost, whereby we were convicted, we were drawn by the Spirit to the bleeding side of the Savior. God, have mercy on your soul. God, have mercy on our souls. We have clear evidence of the power of God. We've seen impressive miracles freely given. And everything tells us that comes from the heart of God. It's all because he loves us. It's because every good and perfect gift comes from above. You did not deserve a miracle. You did not deserve forgiveness. None of us. I thank God that I'm a miracle. I thank God that I'm a miracle. But what about these Pharisees? I said Wednesday about revival being in the heart. Man looks on the outer appearance. God looks on the heart. Had a conversation with a good preacher friend of mine. And he was telling me, he said, I will go anywhere, anytime, and preach to any people. I said, I think that's commendable, and I think we all would. But I can't remember any time in my mind when Jesus went specifically to the Pharisees and said, I want to try to convince you who I am. He rebuked them. He said, you're scribes, Pharisees, Sadducees, you're snakes in the grass. Because they did not believe him. There's nothing worse. There's nothing worse than the instrument of the human heart. I mean by that, do you remember the man that hated David and sought to take David's life? The Bible said God gave him a heart of stone. He lived for 10 days with a heart of stone. Because he sought the life of the man of God. I want to tell you what, folks. God keeps good records. God keeps good records. It's been said, I read this way back in Ripley, Tennessee, that they say that there are instruments that are being made, that every word that's ever been spoken in this earth are still in the air. And they say that there will come a time when they will be able to pull those voices out of the air. They were saying it in a good sense. The Sermon on the Mount is still out there, not only in writing. God said you're going to give an account for everything that you've done. Yes, amen. Every word, yes. Every thought, every blasphemy. That's right. I don't know how long the judgment's going to take. But when the judgment does come, every man has a right to hear the accusations against him and to plead his case. I believe that everything that I've ever said, one of these days, God have mercy on me, will be heard in the judgment. I will give an account for what I said. That's in your Bible. I will give an account for what I do. It's in your Bible. They had so set their hearts against not only the Lord Jesus Christ, but the works that he performed. So what they did, they rejected obvious truth. And they objected and sinned against sight, what they had seen, what they had heard, what was written. These were wicked people, and they're in hell. That's where they belong. When we're talking about an unpardonable sin, do you think that God's going to overlook the unbelief of the Pharisees? The denying by the Pharisees? He's not going to do that. But even worse than that, they tried to influence the crowds. If you don't believe something of God, you better keep your mouth shut. Because whatever you say is recorded, it's out there. And you're going to give an account for every word, act, and deed. How many of that crowd saw and were persuaded to believe? But those Pharisees say, look, I know more than you do. Listen to me. That's who he says he is. That's what they did at the cross. Don't put on there that he's Christ, King of the Jews. Put on that. That's who he said he is. My wife, God love her. I took last Thursday off. She got up Friday and was already dressed to come into the office and got so sick. That woman could get sicker than anybody I've ever seen. Finally just fell back across the bed. So that gave me Thursday and Friday, Saturday, to think about what I would say when I'm representing the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything with him is clean, Christ. Everything with the devil is unclean. The thing that Pharisee did, he said, he cast out devils. Now, they couldn't deny that the devils were cast out. They saw them coming. But they said he did it by Beelzebub. Beelzebub is the god of the dunghill. They said, what he's done, he did by the power of the god of the dunghill. So, well, you know what they're doing? They're including him, are accusing him of sorcery. They are accusing him of being in league with the devil. And you can't get anything more serious than that. Jesus said, I do the work of the Father. If you're denying the power of God to heal, the power of God of miracles, the power of God for anything, you're calling God a liar.
That's right.
I look at things different, and I tell my wife ad nauseum. I tell her, I said, I just pray one thing, that I never bring embarrassment to the gospel. I never bring embarrassment to the gospel. Choose you this day whom you're going to serve. If God is God, serve him. If the devil is God, serve him. If God is God, serve him. Jesus, help me know what to say. We take everybody else's word for it. The doctor says you've got a headache. The doctor says you've got fever. The doctor says you've got a sore throat. The doctor says take my prescription. Jesus in his word says I'm your healer. I'm your physician. I'm your answer. I don't know exactly how God looks at all the things in light of the way that I look. But it is possible to deny clear witness. Hello? You can have a clear evidence and let that thing turn into something that God's not satisfied with. Let me jump down here. These are definitions taken from dictionary. He said, all manner of sin, all manner of blasphemy. So what is blasphemy? Let me say this first. All sins, I got to get this in, all sins shall be forgiven, including blasphemies, except for the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. If you're following in your Bible, you can go to Luke chapter 12 and verse 10. Anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him. But to him who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven. My God. Trying to be use wisdom. The two phrases I looked it up. Who words that speak against or who blasphemes are parallel words. Blasphemy then involves speaking a word against God. I've got to get all of this in, and my time is running short. Blasphemy in its definition involves speaking a word against God. Have you ever said, oh my God? Have we ever used the name of God in a wrong manner? There used to be a person that worked here in this office. And their favorite saying was, oh my God. I'll not tell you who it was, but one of the other employees come to me and told me, said, I shake. I shake every time I hear that. You have to rightly divide the word of truth. We all know that. But when you bring desecration to the holy character of God, if you insult him, mock him, dishonor him, in a sense, what you're doing is the opposite of giving him praise. We're told to praise God. We're told he inhabits the praises of his people. I know where I'm going, so hang on. When Paul, before he'd come to know the Lord, he persecuted the church, even killing. Now, Paul was not blaspheming when he killed. Paul thought he was doing God a favor. He thought everything that he was doing was right. Let me tell you, somebody better preach this gospel, because there are sins such as we've never imagined. God said, my spirit will not always strive with a man. Whenever God brings conviction, that is to bring you to a place of repentance. To not repent and get right with God. I cannot tell you how long God's going to put up with that. My spirit will not always strive. Now, how long is that? I don't know. Let me tell you a story again that I've told before many times. When I was in Tennessee, and that's where I got my boot camp for the ministry. And one night I preached, and there was a man sitting on this side of the church. He was shaking like a leaf in the wind. Actually, they had two sections of pews more in this area. People would come to the altars to be saved. He wouldn't move. I never go to people. I went down and I said, look, I don't know you, you don't know me, but I can see that you're convicted. He sat back in that chair. He was as rigid as a stone. He said, no, sir. I used to preach in a pulpit the same way you preached it tonight. But he said, I got involved in an adulterous affair. You've heard me tell it. He told me this story, and then he stood up and he stalked out of that church. I never saw him again. He said, I got in my car. I would drive to her house, that illicit affair. But he said, one day, what is that unpardonable sin? I don't know. Always. But he said, I got in that car headed for that rendezvous. He said, preacher, he said, I broke out in a sweat when I stopped at a traffic light. I broke out in sweat. He said, I thought I was going to swallow my heart. He said, something said in me, if you walk in that house again, I'm going to cut you off. It's a serious thing. He said, I walked up those steps, got to the porch, whatever it was, knocked on the door, rang the doorbell. And he said, I was terrified. He said, God said, if you go through that door, I'm going to cut you off. For him, that was an unpardonable sin. Though adultery is not unpardonable, it was for him. He said, when she opened that door, so when I stepped across the threshold, God cut me off. Oh, Jesus. Sister Clinton and Brenda, y'all probably don't remember. But when I started going to this church, I started going to this church on June the 2nd, 1962. Brother Clinton and Brother McKnight were in the American Legion Hall having a revival. I'd never seen anything like this. One night, there was a man with a whiskey bottle that went to the altar. Drinking whiskey's not the unpardonable sin. If adultery and whiskey drinking was unpardonable sin, there wouldn't be anybody left in Beaumont. That man walked the aisle, put that whiskey bottle on the altar. I saw it. People prayed with him. Brother Clinton prayed with him. Brother McKnight prayed with him. People crying out to God for that man's salvation. My grandmother, granddad lived on Doucette Street in Beaumont. That's where all the switching of the railroads take place, out there along Doucette, being past all that. One night, still in the revival, we heard late in the night, you know how they just ring those emergency bells on that train when there's been an accident or something. We went because she didn't live from here to 11th Street to that railroad crossing. We got out there. There was a man that had been hit by a train, laying on the tracks dead. You know who it was? The same man with the whiskey bottle that knelt in that altar in the American Legion Hall. About the last thing he had ever heard was the gospel of Jesus Christ. Be not deceived, God is not mocked. I've got to jump over a lot of things. I'm having to get down to where somebody says that's Pharisees. Can Christians commit the unpardonable sin? I sat in my house Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and I labored over this message. My inability to get much reading done. Most of it's with me and God. But in that place of looking what this preacher, that preacher, this preacher, every one of them that I read after said that had to be only in the days of Jesus, and it could only be the Pharisee. I don't believe that. I don't believe that. I believe that the Lord of glory, who saved us and sealed us with the Holy Spirit, is the only one who can keep us from committing an unpardonable sin, whatever it would be, against the living God. Father, I've not done your word justice, but I've tried. How near we are to the end of all things. Oh, You said the end of all things has come up before you. I know that's where we are. I pray that I will in some way help the people to see that it's by the Spirit of God that we're convicted.
That's right.
It's by the workings of the Spirit to bring us to repentance. Yes. Don't let us sin against God, the Holy Ghost. Peter's a good example. If it was just denying the Lord Jesus, he would have committed the unpardonable sin when he said, I know not that man. I know not that man. But there is forgiveness. There is forgiveness. Not for the sin against the Holy Spirit, but for that sin that so easily drags us down, pulls on us. And the point of my message is, I cannot tell you when that may be done for the last time. So we live for Christ. We walk with God. We stay true to the Holy Spirit in our lives. We watch what we say. We watch what we do. We watch what we write down. I didn't get into all of those parts of it, but oh God, there is a record being kept.
Yes,
and I want mine to be clear.
Yes,
through the washing of the blood,
oh,
of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.